a day, and people were getting more and more concerned. We were importing over 50% of our hydrocarbons from the Middle East. Not a good thing. Some of the older wells would have perforations. In other words, they put holes in the pipe that they drilled into the formation. They would shoot small charges that would poke a hole in the pipe periodically. And some of those perforations would go a distance of about 6 inches to a foot into the formation. Well, we started looking at it, and they found that if they used more concentrated explosives to initiate those perforations, the holes would go farther back into the formation and you'd get better flow capacity. Well, they looked at fracturing, and by initiating some fracturing with various methods we'll talk about, they could get 50 times or more production out of the same well. And that started back in 1865, right after the Civil War. A retired officer decided to use some of the explosives he was using in the war instead of blowing up defensive positions. He said, well, let's try putting that down into a well. He had some background in the Pennsylvania oil fields. So he went out there and talked to some people and said, let's try that high explosives. And it worked pretty well. It would perforate, not only blast the pipe to smithereens, but it would cause fractures to go all over the place down there. Not very well controlled, but it increased production considerably. Hey, here's a new idea, nitroglycerin. That's a neat stuff, a very high explosive. And here's a guy pouring it into a device that they would lower down into the well and then detonate it by dropping something down on top of it. Only problem is, when they were trucking it around the country on those bumpy roads in the 1800s and early 1900s, if you go bouncing down a road with that nitroglycerin, they blew up a heck of a lot of trucks and people. And when that happened in a town, there were even more people that got very aggravated or blown up by it. Very dangerous. Well, if nitro works, let's nuke it. The United States went into a series of nuclear devices that they tested. In 1967, down in New Mexico, about 50 miles east of Farmington, they detonated two devices that were about twice as powerful as what we dropped on Hiroshima. So about 30,000 tons of TNT equivalent in that atomic device, and it's less than a mile deep. It caused quite a bit of fracturing. They then went on with some experiments in Colorado. 1969, they activated the device that was about 45,000 tons of TNT equivalent. And they did that over around Ruleson. Another spot, Rio Blanco, 6,000 feet deep, they set off six nuclear devices. Three devices with six times the power of Hiroshima. And they were getting some fairly interesting results. The fractures only extended a few hundred feet. That surprised them. They were getting 300 to 400 feet of fractures. And what they found is not just fractured rubble, but a lot of that was glass and was melted. Boy, they got a good rate of increase on the gas production. It increased quite a bit. But the snag was that when those nuclear devices went off, they created a material called tritium, which is an isotope of hydrogen. It became incorporated into the natural gas. Tritium is higher about 60 or more years ago. The results initially were marginal. They were getting fractures. It would go out about 100 feet or so. And they were limited because of the hydraulic horsepower of the pumps available at that time. the 1970s, service companies that were PAV and then intentionally deviated to the side, and they would deviate anywhere from maybe 20 or 30 degrees angle to as much as 50 or 60 degrees angle. Those were used mainly offshore, where you would have a drilling platform, and then in order to reach a target over there, target over here, you would have to drill a distance in a deviated fashion. And you could target those in a position where you get within about 100 feet of your target at a depth of 5,000, 6,000 or even, and they would stay within a sandstone or a limestone formation that might be only as thick as the height of this room, 10, 20 feet in thickness. And they were able to control it within that zone. And the cost of those wells was up to $1 million to several million. And then all of a sudden, experiments were made using hydraulic fractures in these horizontal wells. At first, some of the engineers didn't think they could be done effectively, but a company called Mitchell in Texas started doing horizontal wells and fracturing those wells in what's called the Barnett Shale down near Dallas-Fort Worth. Is it more difficult in the back?
All right, Mike.
Okay, let's stay with the mic. The experiments done in the Barnett Shale were turning out to be quite successful, and they were testing different types of frac fluids. The reason for using the frac fluid is not just to get rid of some junk water that they don't want around, but they make a frac fluid that has a consistency, think of it almost like pudding. You can put sand in a pudding and it won't fall to the bottom of the bowl, but you put sand in a water glass and the sand will go right down to the bottom of the water glass. So that's what a frac fluid would do. It would be gelled in a way that would carry that frac fluid into that water or retreat it. That poisonous fluid is no longer in there. Some of the pros and cons that I see, and some people may have other pros and cons, but the biggest negative I see is transported material at the surface. Trucking that material, you're always subject to human error and somebody that's driving while sleepy, driving while intoxicated, as in any sort of an automobile or vehicle accident. You can have surface storage failures. If you have the wrong strength steel in a storage container, steel has to be of the proper composition to be able to handle the pressure and fluids that you're dealing with. If you happen to live in the vicinity where this activity takes place, yeah, you're going to get a bunch of trucks that are going back and forth for a period of days while the well is being drilled and a period of days when the well is fracked. And then after that, you have a pump jack or other types of pumping activity that will take place, and there'll be minimal trucking activity going back and forth. It does make oil and gas cheaper for us as consumers. And that's not only a negative, but it's a positive. It's a negative because a lot of the people that are promoting solar energy and wind energy feel that cheap oil and gas makes it less likely that people are going to switch over to the presently more expensive solar and wind energy. But I think at this point in time, we need transition fuels. If human civilization continues for more than just a few years, we're going to have additional sources of energy besides oil and gas. We're going to have to be using renewables. But that's not going to take place overnight. All the emphasis has been put on wind energy and solar energy over the last last 10 or 20 years, I think that now accounts for about 3% of U.S. energy. Not a whole heck of a lot. And there are huge wind farms and huge solar farms, but we need to find more efficient ways to generate electricity through solar and wind and other sources. Some of the pros, the companies are now much more careful about monitoring water wells. The wells that are drilled are protected by multiple strings of steel pipes cemented into place. Sometimes you'll have two, three, or even four strings of different diameter pipe moving in at smaller dimensions with cement in between them, protecting particularly the shallow zones near the surface where we get our water from. It's very important to keep that protected, getting too aggressive in the injection of fluids. And they were getting up to 900 or so earthquakes a year. They have since cut back the injection rates, and here in 2017, the rate of earthquakes is dropping off quite dramatically. It's still higher than it was back 50 years ago, but it is dropping off. And what that water has done being injected into the ground, into the deeper formations, is it's lubricating faults and allowing them to slip and move easier. Not sure how long that's going to persist. It may subside at a rate that would show it tapering off to virtually nothing within 5 or 10 years, or it may stay at that rate of 200 or 300 earthquakes a year. Multiple strings of pipe and cement. You have an oil-producing zone, and then they were injecting into the basement. And the basement is where you have all the fractures and faults. And if you look at highway cuts around here, you'll see the fractures in the rock. And many of the deeper rocks are similar to that, not quite as heavily fractured, but there's a lot of fractures down in this basement. They can inject and used to inject safely with smaller amounts of fluid. And what that means is they may have to have more disposal wells, each one taking much less water. And the advantageous thing to do is put it off to the side of this producing zone where it forces more of the oil back to well bores. You get more effective recovery that way. Okay, we had quite a few oil and oil price fluctuations. And many of us in here are old enough to remember that sudden spike when the Arab oil boycott took place in the 1970s and having to wait around in lines. But oil prices, you can see, just have jumped up and down at tremendous amplitude, going all the way up to $100 plus, down to $30 or $40. And then fracking has boosted our oil supply until right now. We have gone back up to about this 10 million barrels a day production rate that was previously encountered back in 1970. And many people thought that could never be achieved again. They thought this rate of decline would continue and we'd be forever beholden to the Middle East. We used to get a lot of oil from Venezuela. Venezuela is not particularly stable right now. Their production rate has gone way down. They thought that Army officers untrained in oil and gas activity could run the oil fields. They've had a few oops here and there. Their production rate has gone way down. But through fracking, we've been able to increase the rate of production here in the U.S. And what that did is essentially caused a collapse in oil prices throughout the world. That's why oil prices dropped a couple of years back from the $90 to $100 a barrel range down to about $40 a barrel. And that's why I mentioned earlier, fracking, to me personally, my financial situation was adversely affected by that tremendous drop in oil prices due to fracturing. But as a consumer, for myself, and as a consumer that we all are, it's really helped us all in terms of what we pay for gasoline prices. This one, any energy source has drawbacks. So even windmills, you have birds that are killed by windmills, and solar energy has its drawbacks. Any energy source is going to have its pros and cons. And I look at oil and gas as having taken the place of whale oil. We used to use whale oil until about the 1850s or 60s. And then all of a sudden, we're getting into a shortage of whales. And it was tougher and tougher to get enough whales, to get enough whale oil for all of our lanterns. They discovered kerosene that took its place. In order to get kerosene, you needed oil to refine the kerosene. So we've gone through a succession. You know, before that, we were just burning wood or animal tallow, animal fats for candles. And now we're moving towards renewable energy from wind and solar, but it's not going to be an instantaneous change. We're going to need that transition fuel of oil and gas for quite a few more years. So that summarizes what I had to say, and there may be some questions out here. I'm willing to try what I can to field them. And the other gentleman over here I was talking to, he's got a background in oil and gas. He may have some comments to add to the questions or what I've said. But, Linda?
My question, one of them was, well, I was watching television, and they showed in Fort Morgan area or something like that, where they lit the water coming out of the faucet.
Yeah.
Why did they do that?
They did that for sensationalism.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, because it really makes a neat photo on TV.
It's scary.
And the State Oil and Gas Commission was concerned about that. They wanted to be darn sure that there was not a leaking well bore that was flowing gas into a water reservoir. And they did some isotope work on the gas that was coming out of there and found that it was what's called biogenic gas. In other words, bacteria were acting on the organic material, little pieces of coal that were in the water reservoirs, and the bacteria were generating methane gas. Just like when you go out to a pond, you see little bubbles occasionally coming up in a pond. And that's methane gas that's being generated by bacteria acting on the organic material buried in a pond. And that particular incident was completely debunked. There are other incidents. Anytime you have well bores that were drilled 50 or 100 years ago, the standards of pipe, the standards of cementing were not as closely controlled and supervised as they are now. And there are a few wells that have leaked. And those are usually pretty well known. What typically happens is when an oil and gas company takes new leases in an area, they typically incur an obligation to go in, re-enter those wells, and properly plug them. There's also a fee that is imposed on producers of oil and gas to collect money for each of the states to be able to go back in and plug those orphan wells. And that pays for the government to go in there and re-enter those wells and pump cement into them to make sure they don't cross-flow hydrocarbons from one zone into a water zone. That's the last thing anybody wants. not only us as well owners, we don't want that, but oil and gas producers don't want to lose that energy or hydrocarbons from a producing zone. So it's a losing proposition for both sides.
Thank you.
That answer your?
Yes, thank
okay.
you.
Yeah.
At the current rate of extraction, what is the projection of the reserves in number of years?
That's always a running target. Right now, I would suspect with fracturing technology that we have and the expectation that we will have more and more renewable resources, I would expect oil and gas to supply our needs for lubricants and chemical feedstocks and some energy use for the next several thousand years. Back a few years ago, in about 1970, when we hit that peak oil and it started going down, you remember that graph I had a little ways back? Right here. When you take that projection that occurred here, there's a lot of speculation that within about 20 or 30 years, we would not have enough oil and gas to maintain our current standard of living and transportation. But what has happened is, like many other things, human intervention, human innovation has come up with new ideas to recover oil and gas economically from those shales. Before the advent of engineering techniques for horizontal drilling and hydraulic fracturing, you could drill a well through those very prolific shales and you might get a few little burps of gas, but I think we've all had more trouble after dinner time than you could get out of those wells. There just was not enough commercial gas coming out of an unfractured vertical well. But that technology has changed, and now we have enough oil and gas to be able to supply our needs for a considerable period of time. And, yeah, go ahead.
Would you speak just a little about the oil shale, the state of that technology? God,
that's another one. It's always been a running target. It's like the rabbit at the racetrack. The dogs hardly ever catch him. But what has happened is 50 years ago, they thought that oil shale was a tremendous resource, huge amounts of oil potential in those shales. And at that time, oil prices were about $4 a barrel. And they figured, by golly, as soon as that oil price got up to about $15 a barrel, that oil shale is going to become economical. Okay, what has happened is that in the intervening time period, cost of materials, cost of regulations that must be followed, cost of labor, everything has gone up, so that now we're looking at this week $70 oil price. Oil shale may possibly become economic in the neighborhood of $80 or $90 a barrel. But again, there are more and more regulations that go into place. And one thing people forgot about when they were talking about oil shale is that the process of converting the oil shale into a usable oil required quite a bit of water. And the West Slope of Colorado does not have an overabundance of water. And so that's going to be a stumbling block as much as the price. But on anything to do with oil and gas, it's always the economics that drives it. And